Harper Audio presents Nujeen, One Girl's Incredible Journey from War-Torn Syria in a Wheelchair, by Nujeen Mustafa with Christina Lamb, read by Raghad Chaar.
I see Earth. It is so beautiful. Yuri Gagarin, first man in space, 1961. Prologue, The Crossing. Bihlam, Turkey, 2nd September, 2015. From the beach we could see the island of Lesbos and Europe. The sea stretched either side as far as you could see, and it was not rough. It was quiet, flecked only by the smallest of white caps that looked as if they were dancing on the waves. The island did not look too far off, rising from the sea like a rocky loaf. But the grey dinghies were small and low in the water, weighed down with as many lives as the smugglers could pack in. It was the first time I had seen the sea. The first time for everything. Traveling on a plane, in a train, leaving my parents, staying in a hotel, and now going in a boat. Back in Aleppo, I had barely ever left our fifth-floor apartment. We had heard from those who had gone before that on a fine summer day like this, with a working motor, a dinghy takes just over an hour to cross a strait. It was one of the shortest routes from Turkey to Greece, just 8 miles. The problem was that the motors were often old and cheap and strained for power, with loads of 50 or 60 people. So the trips took 3 or 4 hours. On a rainy night, when waves reached as high as 10 feet and tossed the boats like toys, sometimes they never made it at all, and journeys of hope ended in a watery grave. The beach was not sandy as I imagined it would be, but pebbly, impossible for my wheelchair. We could see we were in the right place from a ripped cardboard box printed with the words, Inflatable rubber dinghy, made in China. Max capacity, 15 packs. As well as a trail of discarded belongings scattered along the shore like a kind of refugee flotsam and jetsam. There were toothbrushes, nappies, and biscuit wrappers, abandoned backpacks, and a slew of clothes and shoes. Jeans and t-shirts tossed out because there was no room in the boat, and smugglers make you travel as light as possible. A pair of grey high-heeled mules with fluffy black pom-poms, which seemed a crazy thing to have brought on its journey. A child's tiny pink sandal decorated with a plastic rose. A boy's light-up trainers. And a large grey floppy bear with a missing eye that must have been hard for someone to leave behind. All the stuff had turned this beautiful place into a rubbish dump, which made me sad. We had been in the olive groves all night after being dropped off on the cliff road by the smuggler's minibus. From there, we had to walk down the hill to the shore, which was about a mile. That may not sound much, but it feels a very long way in a wheelchair over a rough track, with only your sister to push and a fierce Turkish sun beating down and driving sweat into your eyes. There was a road zigzagging down the hill, which would have been much easier, but we couldn't walk along that as we might be spotted and arrested by the Turkish gendarmerie, who could put us in a detention center or even send us back. I was with 2 of my 4 elder sisters, Nahda, though she had her baby and 3 little girls to handle, and my closest sister, Nazreen, who always looks after me and is as beautiful as her name, which means a white rose that grows on the hills of Kurdistan. Also with us were some cousins, whose parents, my aunt and uncle, had been shot dead by Daesh snipers in June when they went to a funeral in Kobane, a day I don't want to think about. The way was bumpy. Annoyingly, Nazreen pulled the wheelchair so I was facing backwards and only got occasional glimpses of the sea. But when I did, it was sparkling blue. Blue is my favorite color, because it's a color of God's planet. Everyone got very hot and bothered. The chair was too big for me, and I gripped the side so hard that my arms hurt and my bottom got bruised from all the bumping. But I didn't say anything. As with everywhere we had passed through, I told my sister some local information I had gathered before we left. I was excited that on top of the hill above us was the ancient town of Assos, which had a ruined temple to the goddess Athena, and, even better, was where Aristotle once lived. He'd started a school of philosophy overlooking the sea, so he could watch the tides and challenge the theory of his former master, Plato, that tides were turbulence caused by rivers. Then the Persians attacked and made the philosophers flee, and Aristotle ended up in Macedonia as tutor to a young Alexander the Great. St. Paul, the apostle, also passed through on his own journey to Lesbos from Syria. As always, my sisters didn't seem very interested. I gave up trying to inform them and watched the seagulls having fun gliding on thermals and making noisy loops high in the blue, blue sky, never once stalling. How I wished I could fly. Even astronauts don't have that freedom. Nazreen kept checking the Samsung smartphone our brother Mustafa had bought us for the journey to make sure we were following the Google Map coordinates given to us by the smuggler. Yet, when we finally got to the shore, it turned out we were not in the right place. Every smuggler has their own point. We had colored strips of fabric tied around our wrists to identify us, and we were at the wrong one. Where we needed to be wasn't far along the beach, but when we got to the end, there was a sheer cliff blocking us off. The only way around was to swim, which we obviously couldn't do. So we ended up having to walk up and down another rugged hill to reach the right point on the shore. Those slopes were like hell. If you slipped and fell into the sea, you'd definitely be dead. It was so rocky that I couldn't be pushed or pulled, but had to be carried. My cousins teased me. "You are the queen, Queen Nujeen." By the time we got to the right beach, the sun was setting. An explosion of pink and purple, as if one of my little nieces was squiggling colored crayons across the sky. From the hills above, I heard the gentle tinkle of goat bells. We spent the night in the olive grove. Once the sun had gone, the temperature dropped suddenly and the ground was hard and rocky, even though Nazreen spread all the clothes we had around me. But I was terribly exhausted, having never spent so much time outside in my life, and I slept most of the night. We couldn't make a fire because it might attract police. Some people use the cardboard dinghy cartons to try and cover themselves. It felt like one of those movies where a group go camping and something terrible happens. Breakfast was sugar cubes and Nutella, which might sound exciting, but kind of sucks when it's all you have. The smugglers had promised we would leave early in the morning, and by dawn, we were already on the beach in our life jackets. Our phones were tied inside party balloons to protect them on the crossing, a trick we had been shown how to do in Izmir. There were several other groups waiting. We had paid $1,500 each instead of the usual $1,000 to have a dinghy just for our family. But it seemed others would be in our boat. We would be 38 in total, 27 adults and 11 children. Now we were here, there was nothing we could do. We couldn't go back, and people said the smugglers used knives and cattle prods on those who changed their minds. The sky was cloudless, and close by I could see that the sea wasn't just one color, the uniform blue of pictures and my imaginings, but bright turquoise next to the shore, then a deeper blue darkening to gray, then indigo near the island. I knew the sea only from National Geographic documentaries, and now it was as if I was part of one. I felt really wired and couldn't understand why everyone was nervous. For me, it was like the biggest adventure. Other kids were running and collecting pebbles of different colors. A small Afghan boy gave me one, the shape of a dove, flat and gray, with a white marble vein running through it. It was cool to the touch, and worn smooth by the sea. It's not always easy for me to hold things in my awkward fingers, but I wasn't letting go of that. There were people from Syria like us, as well as from Iraq, Morocco, and Afghanistan, speaking in a language we didn't understand. Some people swapped stories, but most didn't say much. They didn't need to. To be leaving all you knew and had built up in your own country to make this dangerous and uncertain journey, it must be bad. As morning broke, we watched the first boats go out. Two set off more or less straight, but two were going in all directions. The boats didn't have pilots. What happened was, the smugglers let one of the refugees travel for half price, or for free, if he drove the boat, even though none of them had any experience. "It's just like riding a motorbike," they claimed. My uncle Ahmed was going to be driving our boat. I guessed he'd never driven one, as we had never been to the sea and his old job was running a mobile phone shop. But he assured us he knew how. We'd heard that some refugees gun the motor to get halfway across to Greek waters as fast as possible, and they burn out the motor. Sometimes engines don't have enough fuel. If that happens, the Turkish coast guards catch you and bring you back. In Cafe Sinbad in Izmir, we'd met a family from Aleppo who had tried to cross 6 times. We didn't have money to keep trying. Around 9 a.m., Uncle Ahmed called the smuggler, but he said we must wait for the coast guard to go. "We have chosen the wrong smuggler," said Nazreen. "I worried we had been cheated again. We hadn't expected to be here so long, and we're soon hungry and thirsty," which was ironic as there was so much water in front of us. My cousins went to try and find water for me and the children, but there was nothing nearby. The day got hotter. Though the smuggler had arrived with dinghies for us and the other groups, he said we couldn't go until the coast guard changed shift. The Moroccan men were half naked and started singing. As the afternoon came, the waves started to get higher, making a slapping sound on the shore. None of us wanted to go at night, as we'd heard stories of kind of pirates on jet skis who board boats in the dark to steal motors and the valuables of refugees. Finally, around 5 p.m., they said the coast guards were changing guard so we could take advantage and go. I looked again at the sea. A mist was coming down and the cry of the seagulls no longer seemed so joyful. A dark shadow lay over the rocky island. Some call that crossing Rihle al-Mot, or the route of death. It would either deliver us to Europe or swallow us up. For the first time, I felt scared. Back home, I often watched a series called Brain Games on National Geographic, which showed how feelings of fear and panic are controlled by the brain. So I began practicing breathing deeply and telling myself over and over that I was strong. Part 1. To Lose a Country. Syria. 1999 to 2014. Before they are numbers, these people are first and foremost human beings. Pope Francis, Lesbos, 16th of April, 2016. Chapter 1. Foreigners in Our Own Land. I don't collect stamps, or coins, or football cards. I collect facts. Most of all, I like facts about physics and space, particularly string theory. Also about history and dynasties, like the Romanovs, and controversial people like Howard Hughes and J. Edgar Hoover. My brother Mustafa says I only need to hear something once to remember it exactly. I can list you all the Romanovs, from the first one, Tsar Mikhail, to Nicholas II, who was murdered by the Bolsheviks along with all his family, even his youngest daughter Anastasia. I can tell you exactly what date Queen Elizabeth II became Queen of England, both the day her father died and her coronation, and the dates of both her birthdays, actual and official. I'd like to meet her one day and ask her, "What's it like having Queen Victoria as your great-great-grandmother?" And Isn't it odd everyone singing a song about saving you? I can also tell you that the only animal not to make a sound is a giraffe, because it has no vocal cords. This used to be one of my favorite facts, but then people started calling our dictator Bashar al-Assad.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.